there 24/7, and when it is not there, those who work in AD and those who are employed in Mercy Care do know that it's not there.
Okay, I want to take Keith to the DJ.
Yes, I mean, it's echoed the two previous ones there. In the no force first approach, and the idea of dealing with these issues, not as a uniformed service going out to people who are ill, but responding as part of civic society to people in distress. That's the way we do it. And I really liked, and I wanted to applaud your points about how the police getting involved when people are very stressed can actually make the situation worse because of their paranoia. And I think the attitude that you're displaying all of these areas is really commendable. So I think it's great.
Thank you.
First of all, thank you very much for welcoming the force for the opportunity to talk to you about this project. Just to make a point to you, it is, they are still, but unfortunately, perceived by some as a project. So I completely hear what you're saying as health commissioners about evolving services, making sure that going forward you've got services that fit. Our idea would be to see this bedded in, so that, for example, Sefton have made the decision to keep this going and write it into budgets. Other commissioners around Merseyside, it's still a year, as you saw on the slide, up to 2017. So we wanted to get in to say, while we're considering how to, what to commission them and where, it would be of immense benefit to the Merseyside Police to be engaged in that discussion with you. Because at the moment, this is what we see that works. If there are other things that work, we would be, delighted to hear about them and to learn about them, and we're with you in delivering it. But at a time when all budgets are shrinking, this is something that's a genuine investment project. If you spend money on this now, then the benefits to society later are tangible and very difficult to measure, but enormous. So I just leave that thought with you, and very grateful, Chair, and thank you. And thanks for listening to the questions.
No, thanks, Jane. Thank you for the presentation. It was a good presentation. I think the initiative is great. I'd like to see understand how we look at that particular issue. I'm now going to bring back to the agenda, and Chris Walsh will tell you what to do if we have a fire. It will make me a little bit. Okay, we then move on to declaration of interest and receive them. The minutes of the last meeting on pages 1 to 14 of your agenda. So can I see if there are any issues of accuracy within that or any matters arising from anyone? Okay, so can we agree then? As read, given that we have taken most items now, we then go on to item 7, which is the Safeguard the Children Board annual report, and that's a lengthy report of the agenda. Howard is going to take us through, and also a lengthy report. I hope Howard will do.
Soon, we will. We are very happy to take questions, comments, or systematic approaches to audit, to case reviews, to hearing voices from people, and increasingly from my professionals, although it's fair to say that some of those are certainly valid and not very right at the bottom of the world. And an improving approach to data, though it's also fair to say across agencies, that is challenging because of different recording methods, different coding methods, sections and so on. So that is not a job that you haven't finished, but we're certainly on our way with that. There's a clear approach to CSA across the partnership, across council services, health services and police, and that involvement and engagement, heavy engagement, police in particular, over the past 3 years has led to better intelligence understanding of the profile. So an awful lot, and you'll see in my report, a lot of focus on CSE. There's a widening engagement of partners in preventative and early health work around the early health strategy and early health work. So that's really only been going for 12 months since it's going forward. But he's showing impact, and he's showing effect, and he's widening almost by the day. But we are continuing to see high demands for services from children and people and families, and people perceiving the risks and needs there. And as a consequence, high caseload levels across all agencies and all sorts of professional work across the partnership. And consequent high levels of stress, both in terms of members of public and families, and the professionals we're seeking to help them. We're seeing some sense amongst the workforce of fear of change, as the issues that you talk about at all your meetings are very impacting on people, and consequences in the way that the job is being done. And we see high medium-term risks, as again those who saw some other issues bite even more over the next few years. That's the context that I see. And now I'm telling a story which illustrates some of those things. It's a true story. It relates to a child where we became aware of the case early in this particular year that we were reporting on. I changed some of the details to protect their identity, as you might imagine. I'm going to give a brief resume. And as I do that, I'd just like to think of two things, really. First thing I'd like you to think about is, from your professional perspective, your understanding, which professionals in which agencies might have been productively involved with this little girl as the story develops, and how might they work together? And the second thing I'd like you to think about is, if you were writing the story for a national newspaper, try to think what you might write if you were writing from the perspective of each of the actors in turn. How might you see it in relation to each of those actors? Okay. So the story revolves around Sophie. Sophie is an 8-month-old baby. Sophie's mother, Leanne, is 16. She has learning disabilities, weight problems, mental health issues, and self-harms. She lives with her own mother, Denise, and there's a history of neglect during Leanne's childhood. much of my report revolves around those issues that, that are highlighted by sort of this story. So what for me seems to be the key issue facing the partnership over the next few years or this period of time include the following. I've got two really. One is to do frontline working, the other is to do strategic working. So to do frontline working, we need to develop further, even more, ways of reducing the progression from children living in challenging family circumstances to statutory intervention. As you know, the principle is in this country, we don't, the state doesn't intervene in families unless it needs to do for the protection of children. So the game is partly about doing that intervention effectively, but it's mostly about stopping getting to that in the first place. And I absolutely understand that the pressures on all of your budgets will really tend to focus on the most acute need. Whereas I'm saying, if you're going to make a difference, you have to focus on the chronic need, not the acute need, not over there, but the acute need. So early help is absolutely the key. And although it's early days, we do see some impact on that. There needs to be more strengthening of families in communities. And we need to think families that all have now, but we need to think in terms of the way that the families work. We see the development of early help hubs and early help teams, sometimes virtually as well as physically, increasingly happening. We hope to see police officers located in those teams in the very near future. We've already got health professionals. The only thing in that space is the hope to complete the work goal or getting there, which tells you the story, doesn't it? And that is wholly positive from our evidence. We need to get a much better, I was going to say understanding of levels of BDS, but I don't actually mean understanding. I defy anybody to read the gallows and not understand what we mean by indeed in section 47 or whatever it might be, level 2, level 3, level 4. I defy anybody not to understand. It's actually about acceptance of and embedding those in the way that we work, not just about understanding the sort of academic way. We need to have, and this relates very strongly to the previous sentence, we need to have effective triage so there can be effective signposting, effective consultancy to professionals on the ground so they can, so people like education, social welfare officers can provide support in schools rather than it having to get to later. Effective escalation and de-escalation as that support means that the family requires less external intervention. Stepping up, stepping down. We need effective funding up front, not just at the critical stage. That's the frontline stuff. More effective partnership working at the front line. And then more strategically, what we see as a board, we're one of, I don't know, what, 5, 6, 7, 8 partnership boards that we have in the city dealing with the people's side. The Adult Safe Government Board, the Children's Trust, City Safe, a whole range of partnership boards. Increasingly, the work that we do interacts with those demonstration rooms. Every single one since I've been there have been on babies under one. And yet the number of referrals that we get from maternity services is close to zero. There was one last year. One number, not 1%. One. The number of referrals that we get from the health physician for early health and for Max's system. In fact, she was small. It has gone up. In fact, the number of our score we previously thought was put together. So we are getting somewhere like that. But the eye off the ball syndrome, whilst believers are thinking about issues regarding item one, is really pertinent and does affect workers on the ground, school nurses, health visitors, midwives, and all the rest. So, my parting message, if you like, would be amongst all the difficulties, amongst all the partners are facing, health is, in my opinion, is the most challenging. And the final bit is that if you haven't enough with all of that, there is a bill before Parliament. And that bill, if enacted in its present form, will abolish the statutory functions of LSCVs. And instead, it will give new statutory functions for the City Council, the Merseyside Police, and the NHS Law Committee, whatever that might mean. It will be for the partnership to work out how its safeguarding interventions ought to work. It's not for me to make a judgment about the effect of the LSCVs do. But you've got to give some mechanism or some sort, something similar, if you like, to be able to do that, just to keep the eye on the ball. We anticipated that becoming law in this summer. I suspect the result of Brexit, it's now looking rather longer than that. It's looking like it will get through the laws this summer. They will write, they'll go to the Commons in the autumn. They'll write statutory guidance, they'll consult on the statutory guidance, and it will have a commencement sometime in the summer of 2018. So you've got about an 18-month period, I guess, between now to be going, and you're having whatever arrangements you put in place. And that's a golden period, really, if the act hasn't been enacted yet. I think that will be challenging at a partnership level, while each partner is trying to sort out their own massive issues. So I've really enjoyed this review, so looking at the end of the report, and I think we've made the partnership, has been a huge partnership, progress, and I wish you all for the future.
Okay, well, that completely sort of made it, especially with the two things we've got to talk about, for sure. But the same questions we posed, the same what did we do with the case scenario of the Sophie and the family, was one that I could have created 20 years ago and asked the same questions. That hasn't changed, and the threshold of the issues that need to be looked at equally, but also the issues of funding, and to me that's something that is concerning. However, as somebody that's been a leader for the last 10 years and seen more and more responsibilities, passports and things, and more and more difficult to manage situations because of the difficulties. That is not going to change. I think, if I take you back to the couple of years, we would be similarly discussing that case and what we need to do. But it's important that you raise the issue, because I think we have got to look at and be prepared for when the Act is likely to be passed and what we would do and how we respond to it. So does anybody want to collect you on the end of the weekend?
Yeah, thank you, Howard, for that, and we will be very, very conscious of speaking and thinking over. I recognise that case and know exactly who that is. and we really need to look at more services like the triage car, because they're the things that help us to prevent those things escalating, working with our partners. And I think the last thing I would say is trying to manage risk is the biggest thing for us. People are very uncomfortable with risk, and they want to pass that risk to children's social care. And I absolutely understand why that is. But we have to get, as a partnership, we have to understand these are all our children as a city, and we have to be prepared to manage the risk. We cannot simply pass it to the council. So a lot of my time is spent with schools and other partners, and we clearly will need to do more with health partners, police, with everyone, to manage those thousands, because we simply cannot add to the numbers of looked after children endlessly.
Thanks, Mayor. It may sound like a fairly tenuous link, but I wanted to bring the board's attention to something called the resettlement passport. I was asked to speak in my capacity as cabinet member for housing at the launch of the passports early in November. And the passports targeted at young people coming out of care and setting up their own home. And it gives them the basic skills, or tries to give them the basic skills to deal with the challenges they'll face when they come out of care and they suddenly find themselves in a flat or somewhere on their own. And I think that resettlement passport may be one of the small measures that Howard refers to where you can make a difference and try and protect people when they come from what was a very protected childhood and they suddenly find themselves on their own. So it's a small step, but it's something I think we've done with our partners, with local solutions and with the housing associations, to give those young people a better chance when they go out into the world on their own.
Okay, thank you for that, Fred. Tim?
Yeah, thanks, Jeff. Very interesting report. I thought JT and I, joint inspection, actually helped the police because Ken and Mira to show where they were going, they needed to improve, even though it was critical. Sometimes we have to accept criticism when it's valid. In fact, we always have to accept criticism when it's valid. One comment, though, that the ongoing anxiety I have, which Howard has touched upon, is we do well when we are helping people in the extreme crisis where they need that help. And they come to care and we provide duty care. Very similar experience with domestic abuse. Domestic homicide reviews, the incidents, tend to be cases that are not what we call the gold cases. So the gold cases, in other words, those that are already at the point where all of the emergency services and support services know this is a critical case, that case gets critical help.
back to the agenda, and then that was just for number five, by the way, obviously discussion and debate. Can we move on to item 8 now, which is the cancer strategy report. Can I invite Sandra to address this on page 197 of your agenda?
Okay.